Morning. Today is such an incredibly special day, and it's not because it's actually raining in California, but it's graduation, and it's a real honor to be here. Dean Yannis Yortsis, members of the Board of Counselors, members of the faculty, proud parents, and above all graduates, the first thing I'd like to say is thank you. Not only has USC given me an extraordinary honor by asking me to speak to you, but has also forced me to take time to reflect on what I wish someone had told me when I graduated 21 years ago. But as I reflected on my own graduation, I realized that I could not remember even a single word, which fortunately sets my bar very low. Graduation is a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Okay, right now I'm a little bit uncomfortable. Giving this talk, I'm wearing a tie. Especially, I'm not even trained as an engineer, yet I have the honor to share some thoughts with all of you about the world you're launching into. You've all accomplished so much already in your life just to get here today, and I know that you will 10 times that over the next many decades. As you think about all that opportunity and expectations of your future, you should start feeling a bit uncomfortable. At least I hope so. In fact, I'm standing here now to encourage you to constantly seek out what makes you uncomfortable, to dive into endeavors you find scary, maybe even terrifying. That's because complacency is the enemy of achievement. Fear sets you free to do more, try more, and accomplish more than you think you can. And when you overcome your fears, it's exhilarating. 10 years ago this month, I went to Nepal to climb Kalapatar and visit the base camp of Mount Everest in the Himalayas. Before heading there, I read all about the trek, reviewing photos of the many, many bridges that we would have to cross as we climbed from 8,000 over 19,000 feet. By the way, I really hate heights. Of course, so with the bridges being in this horrendous state, most of which have now all been replaced since then, I was concerned. Yet I had no choice. I had to cross these dilapidated bridges. So each time we came across one, I made my crossing by focusing on getting across slowly, one plank at a time, and over time, I slowly became more comfortable. Although, to be honest, I still really hate heights. So I'm here now to challenge you and hope that by sharing a few of my observations and experiences that I will help you do just that throughout your professional lives. First, you need to get comfortable being uncomfortable. Okay, what does that actually exactly mean? Being able to seek out discomfort and wrestle fear is something that we must all learn to do in our professional lives. When I joined Twitter in 2010, the site had become infamous for constantly being down and then displaying the infamous fail whale, putting the understaffed engineering team under incredible stress and making the investors very nervous. Twitter's survival was at stake if we didn't fix the service and fix it soon. But how do you fix a system that is running millions of transactions a second, growing exponentially? It was the network equivalent of performing open heart surgery on a patient who's running a marathon and, oh, by the way, running sub 6 minute miles. Believe me when I say we were all out of our comfort zone and we were all very afraid. But like crossing the bridges in the Himalayas, we focused on making progress in small segments. We outlined where we wanted to be in 18 months, set up short-term goals, and began slowly but surely making progress to rebuild the infrastructure from the ground up in an evolutionary way. At the same time, we also grew the team almost 5x, which again made us all feel incredibly uncomfortable. There was no reference guide for this kind of growth, no best practices, similar problems to frame the solution. We had to invent and define it, and we were going to make mistakes, as the only way to make a mistake is by actually doing something. You can't make a mistake without doing, and you cannot push the boundaries without breaking them. We discovered quickly that we had to build programs to help those engineers ramp up as they joined to help stabilize the service. Again, we paused, built an incremental plan, and made progress. Earlier in my career, when I was starting composite software, I recall the uncomfortable situation of being a first-time CEO. After successfully raising a Series A financing in the summer of 2002 for $6 million, fortunately, only one of a handful of companies that did, I had to turn this then project with 5 engineers out of my house into a real company and hire employees outside of just engineers. How would I hire a VP of sales when I had never even conducted a sales meeting? I felt tremendous pressure between both the employees and investors who were relying on me to deliver. Yet, I really had no idea of what I was doing, which in an odd way made this situation even more attractive. Second, seek mentors to help you navigate through these uncomfortable situations. I've always found that one of the strengths of the entrepreneurial community is the pay-it-forward approach to helping. Ask other founders, ask ex-executives, ask current executives, ask for introductions to people you have read about that you think might be helpful. Look on LinkedIn, ask for introductions to Viterbi alumni. As long as you're respectful of his or her time and use it wisely, I've yet to find someone unwilling to help. Now, this may seem like a very straightforward set of guidance, but I also know that many of you are introverts. And for what it's worth, I am as well. However, when you take on the uncomfortable challenge of being a leader, founder, or CEO, you have the responsibility to your team to do whatever it takes to succeed. Is this easy? No. I have often found that the many required professional social events, whether they're dinners, presentations, or networking events, to be both incredibly critical for the business and yet completely exhausting. Again, at the end of the day, you just have to get comfortable being uncomfortable. And let's be honest, to a degree, we're all faking it on some levels. And if you don't think you are, then you're fooling yourself. We all need to and must project an image, and that is okay, really. So while you may be uncomfortable as you try out something for the first time, know that you are not alone. As I've always told leaders on my team, if you tell your team to take that hill in battle, then your team must believe that you will take it, regardless of how you are feeling inside. I can recall after joining Palm to design, build, and ship WebOS, I made the decision to reset our efforts after my first 30 days, and I was really not sure if we would be able to deliver a brand new mobile platform in 10 months. Huh? This is crazy, I would hear. I had no idea of how we were going to do it, rebuild a team, build a new mobile platform for a phone, the cloud, and all this build it while building a delightful user experience. But despite my constant internal questioning, I never let my team sense that I had any doubts or question my confidence in them to deliver a great product on time. After accomplishing various feats, such as your graduation today, you'll see how this often can lead to imposter syndrome. That is, despite external evidence of your competence, those with the syndrome are made convinced that he or she is a fraud and do not deserve the success that they have achieved. Are you experiencing this today? If not today, you likely will eventually. I have. One of the realizations that comes with experience is you discover that nobody really knows what they're doing. This dispels the imposter syndrome very quickly. Once you think you know how a business or industry works, you develop patterns to solve it. This can sometimes work against you because you can be blinded from the constant change that happens while other people figure out different and possibly better ways to do things. So keep listening, surround yourself with people who will disagree and question you with the intent of pushing the possibilities. To be clear, this is different than people who just pontificate or argue. I have felt all these emotions and feel that today even as a general partner at a world-renowned venture capital firm. But I remind myself that at my core, I know how to build, I know what I don't know, I know how to find great people, I know how to learn, and I know how to have fun, and I know I have much to learn. Thirdly, spend time talking with non-engineers. Another area that is critical to get comfortable being uncomfortable with is communicating with people not like you. So hang out with non-engineers if you can, as it will increase your range of ability to understand and communicate with other people. Beyond helping you professionally, these interactions will typically provide for a great deal of entertainment and insights. Turns out salespeople can often perform great karaoke. So find people who will challenge your thoughts because of their diverse skills. Their unique perspective brings a different solution that you would not have necessarily proposed. Fourthly, seek diverse perspectives. The ability to communicate and learn from a wide set of audiences is particularly critical if you have a desire to go build products, which many of you likely are. In this case, spending time with designers to truly understand their creative process will increase the probability of building a great product that delights users. Empathy in building great products is critical. Fifth, professional risk is overrated for engineers. In general, we tend to overestimate risk as we look towards decisions in our life, especially with a degree in engineering. You are graduating today with an engineering degree and have such a very wide aperture of what you can spend your time on. Know that you can always change your decision. So try things out, fail, try again. Keep iterating until you find your calling. There has not been a time like today for engineers to make a real impact in this world in a positive way. So to find your place, iterate, fail. When I left working on my PhD at the University of Washington, I did not have a grand plan to eventually become a venture capitalist. I went from role to role based on my interests, the people I would be working with, the impact of my work, and the problems I would be working on. I've kept that same philosophy to this day. Life is not about waiting for the storm to pass. It's learning to dance in the rain, as Vivian Green said. Lastly, keep building. An area that I had underestimated in my own area of discomfort is getting too far away from building real products. Throughout my career, I've always had a side project that required me to build. Beyond finding writing software relaxing, it reassures me that I'm not too far from the technical details such that I'm not legit. So while I'm cautious of ever being prescriptive technically, either as a venture capitalist or a leader of an engineering team, I ensure that my knowledge enables me to be able to ask the right questions to either guide or assess the team's technical ability. One of the key outcomes of your college experience is that you've learned how to learn and be curious. Hopefully, you've acquired the desire to always continue to do so. You'll be tested to unlearn various notions and assumptions. A great example of learning and then unlearning for me personally was when I moved from building WebOS at Palm to leading engineering Twitter to stabilize the service. From a first-generation mobile platform that had to work for consumers 100% of the time, to deploying software into production without any testing for a service that runs 24/7. From building a 1.0 piece of software that if it did not work would doom the company, to an online service that if it went down would also doom the company. Two critical products with very different cultures and key metrics. You are all beginning on an entrepreneurial journey of yourself starting today. Basically, in my world, you just closed your round of venture financing. So now what? I can't tell you what your path will or should be, but I can say that the opportunities are immense right now in your field, from 3D printing to virtual reality to mobile to the implications of sequencing a genome for less than $1,000. Again, your biggest risk is pursuing a journey whereby you're too comfortable. One of the curious things about being uncomfortable is to be curious about why you are uncomfortable. I have found that leaning into what you do not know is critical for success, despite the internal turmoil that one experiences. You have learned how to learn. Your curiosity has been cultivated. Through a combination of curiosity and uncomfortable journeys, I know you will deliver on your dreams, regardless if they are in engineering or not. Mario Andretti, the famous race car driver, once said, "If everything seems under control, then you're just not going fast enough." The things that scare you are what makes life an adventure. It's the unexpected twists and turns that yield the most surprise and delight. The nights you didn't think you'd stay out late, the trips you had not planned on taking. I know you're there. Go do great things. Thank you for listening, and congratulations to the USC Viterbi School of Engineering Class 2015. Fight on!